All right, I'm going to start this video off showing you how to fix a hole without welding. I have some holes in my truck here where I'm going to use some of this stuff here. This is a POR 15 epoxy putty. Works really amazing for fixing these holes. Like, I've got a few little pinholes along here. Some of it's where I burned through with a plasma cutter. Kind of hard to weld those up, and it might be kind of thin. And that's a little tiny rust hole. That one is too. And it's really hard to grind in there, in that area. It's only like this wide on the inside. I'll show you. Just like there. You can't really grind in there very well, so it's kind of hard to work with. So it's a lot easier if I put some epoxy putty over that. That's why I decided to do it this way. So I'm going to knead some of that up. I'm going to put it in these holes. It actually works really nice to, you can sand it. And it's super strong. It doesn't necessarily need to go over bare metal, but I think it can. I've done it over sanded paint, and it works fine. And it doesn't say that it has to be over bare metal on the product package or the data sheet. So I've done it both ways, and it doesn't crack and fall off. It works pretty good. So that's why I'm using that on this. Anyway, we'll get started with that, and then I'll continue on with some more things here shortly. Inside the package was part A and part B. Take equal parts of both and knead them together. It's pretty simple. But I'll show you the whole thing. Let's open this up a second. Then you knead this stuff up. So it's a little stiff. It's kind of cold out right now. So some of these things, some of these epoxy putties, if you roll them up your hand like this, it'll get hot and it won't work. It'll dry before you get a chance. This one doesn't, so I can roll it in my hands to kind of warm it up, and it doesn't make it dry too fast like some of them do. If you've ever used those, they take, you know, it's really hard. Do that, and I twist it, so like that, just to get it to mix up. Sorry about that phone ring. Of course, I don't even have a real ringer. I saw the T-Mobile one, right? I don't even change all that stuff. It's funny, I used to have a ringer on my phone, and it would say, it was so funny, it went like this, it went, you know, answer the phone, I put my voice in there, and I put it, answer the phone, and it'd say, answer the phone, you idiot, answer the phone. be walking around, people would hear that when I'm walking around, they would just crack it out laughing. Couldn't believe I was doing that. Answer the phone, you idiot, answer the phone. Yeah, it was fun. That was a long time ago. I've done all kinds of crazy stuff in my life. Anyway, I'll get this thing all done. I just make a snake. Make another snake. It's starting to work now. Make another snake. It doesn't make it dry too fast, though. So that's the concern a lot of people are going to have. It doesn't make it dry too fast. This stuff takes about, I get about, I don't know, about 20, 30 minutes maybe of working time with it. Maybe not quite that long, I don't know, 20 minutes, 15 minutes. Gives you quite a bit of time still. Some of them are only like 2 or 3 minutes. That's when you get a little more time. And takes about, I'd say about 3 to 4 hours or so before it's really workable to sand. So, anyway, I'll get this all mixed up and we'll take a look at what we can do with it. So you guys know the rust hole, I did treat the area with a rust converter. So the rust is inactive. So anyway, what I do is I just take little pieces of it. And like I said, if you really want to get it nice, you get a, it's better if you do that while it's primed, you know, if you have some sort of paint or finish on it, sand it a little bit. But you can get your fingers wet or get the putty, you can dunk the putty in water, and it, I don't know, it's like, has some sort of a, like a water solution to it. It's water soluble or something, and it, what it does is it makes it so you can kind of smear it, and you can take, I use this for steering wheel repair, all kinds of stuff like that, and you can, it doesn't work the greatest for steering wheel repair. I mean, J&B Weldware works a little bit better, it's a little stronger. This stuff's a little bit kind of weak as far as that goes. It's better for stuff like this though. It actually works amazing for this. So I stick it on both sides, and I leave it a little bit mounted when I sand it. So I'm not going to try and sand this down like super flat. I'll get it to where it's got like a little maybe a fit, you know, not quite a 16th of raise, and I'll feather it in with filler. So it's not a perfect fix. We'll do these holes here. I got a few of them to do. So I just do that. It's really nice and strong. Stuff holds up pretty good. It doesn't usually crack out. Like, it's good for things that filler. You don't really want to use filler on it. Like, if I just fill this in with filler, it might just fall out of there. If I use this, it'll be fine. It'll last for years. Way past the life of the paint job. So, put some on both sides to make sure the hole is completely filled, because sometimes it'll just push through. So anyway, I'll get all that done. I'll do this, I'm gonna sand this tomorrow. I just wanted to get it filled today. Yeah, let's do this little section of the video. You know, some of those videos that I do, guys, you guys might think I did the repair in, you know, just a few hours. Sometimes it's like I've done like 10 minutes at a time over 3 or 4 days. So it looks, but it's weird how I can get it to flow together by edit. So it looks like, yeah, you just did that right then. All at the same time, you look at my clothes, and I've changed clothes like 4 times because I've worked on it 4 days. It's an illusion. All right, let's finish this up. I'll keep making video. I'll talk to you guys later on the video. Well, my putty's dry, so I can sand that off. Get the mountains down to where they're smooth. It sands really easy. I cleaned this up. You know, a lot of guys watch videos on YouTube and they think that they watch one guy and he makes all his metalwork look like he's just got rid of all the welds and it's all smooth. And I think that's how it has to be. That's not really how it has to be. The finish is what you're looking for. This is just filled in with metal. It's close enough to the surface to where I won't have very much filler in it. It's going to be within an 1/8 to 1/4 inch at the most. Maybe the deepest area could be 1/4, but I doubt it. And I still have a good finish. So, you know, you don't have to look at the metal and see that it's exactly the way it needs to be. The filler is there for a reason. You know, if you're trying to do a metal finish, that's something else. And that's not necessary. It's just, you know, like I say to people, that's more bragging rights than anything. You know, we're looking for a finished product that looks good and not trying to impress all our buddies about how we can make the metal look perfect.
Check the mic and make sure it sound right, boys. Sound right, boys.
Let's take a look here. Got a coat of primer on here just to basically to give myself some reference. What I'm going to do is primer this, and then I'm just going to guide coat this real quick. There's a lot of little places. I mean, I got little stuff like this, you know, little stuff all around all the corners, edges, little welding to clean up there with some putty. It's wavy. So all that gets all taken care of with primer. Primer, and we're going to use some glazing on this. So that's how I do it. I don't always try and make everything right before I put the primer on. It's a little easier that way. It's a lot easier to find things when you put a little bit of guide coat on there. So I'll put some on with you guys. I'll let you guys do it with me. Well, let's take a look. Well, one of the things I was going to say is you see these X's on here. I'm not going to try it. It usually has like a round here, and then it kind of goes around over there, and it goes around up here. I'm not going to probably get all that line to come back. I'm not going to try to. And I'm just going to kind of make it blend in so you kind of see the X, but it won't be really as prominent maybe as some of the other restorations. This was just in too bad a shape back here to do like that, so I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to make it, you know, to where it, you can kind of see the X, and, you know, of course there's going to be a lift on here. There's going to be all this stuff in the way. So it's going to be, there's going to be so much going on with this truck that it's going to be hard to see a lot of the flaws. It's kind of like, you know, restoring a semi, you know, you don't, you know, a semi truck or something like that. You're not going to get it like as perfect as you do, like, say, for instance, you know, a show car or a car or something like that. We're not going to do it that way. We're going to do like a mini resto to kind of make it look original. So I may not even try and really get it, like, I'm not going to do this right away. There's some stuff up in here, edgy stuff, all the edges up there. It's a little wavy, all that. All it's going to get cleaned up, you know, and I do it with this. So I'll just mist a coat of black. There's a lot of different types of guide coat. Some guys use the powder now. They didn't used to have that years ago. I just go to the old school, you know, throw a little black paint on there. Let's try widening this up. You guys can see a little bit better. You guys can actually see better than me. I got the camera focused right in my face, so it's a little harder to do. And I just kind of wipe over it with a little guide coat. You know, that's all going to come off. I'll have to get my little finger sander in there to do some of that. So I just figured I'd just do it after primer. Just get a little something on here. Didn't put a real heavy coats on here. Just a couple medium coats on here. So I'll do that. And I'll glaze it all up. I'll go ahead and sand it. It'll show me where all the low parts are. When you sand it like this, if there's a low spot, you'll see all that black. And so when you sand everything, you kind of see all the black low spots, or, you know, a little bit of speckle there. It makes it easier to find stuff. And when you feel it, when you see that and feel it at the same time, it's a lot easier to reference what you're looking at, you know, because sometimes you'll feel it and you'll think, hey, is that a high spot or a low spot? This kind of takes the guesswork out of that. And then I'll go through and sand my lines and sand some of the edges. I'll probably do it several times. I'll probably do another coat of primer after this. And then I'll probably put, you know, probably a third or fourth on this one, just because it was so bad. There's, you know, there's a lot to do. So, you know, it depends on how bad it is. Usually it's only 2 to 3 times. This one might have to do 4. So, I don't know. We'll just play it by ear and do it up and get it all straight. And of course, it'll look just like as if I, you know, made the metal perfect. You know, I could make it even that perfect if I wanted to, but I probably won't go quite that far. So I'll just make it, you know, visibly, you know, not so you don't look at it and just see a bunch of stuff, you know, and I'll just make it look decent, but you may not see all that perfect originalness, you know, that it had. It's just too much work to do on something like this. Right. Just did a quick cleanup on the inside here. Yeah, I got that a little bit cleaned up. I'm going to do, of course, a lot more work there. You know, I'm working on these strips here. These I'm going to put on around like this. Okay. They're going on here. And what it's for is for so that when I put the bed pieces on, it'll fold over this, because I think there was another layer on these. I'm not sure, but I'm just going to do it all even all the way around, I guess. Put a layer, a strip of metal all the way across here, all the way around on everything. Like I said, I don't have the original. I think the original ones went up. I think these pieces here had like a lip, and then this piece went up against that lip, and then or something like that. I don't really know, because they're not in good enough condition. Let's look at the other ones. Here's one of the ones I took off. It looks like it had two pieces on there. You can see two layers right there. And then there's the bed top on top of that. Again, to save costs, we had to use the square tubing. And I don't even know if these outer pieces are available. There's a lot of pieces that aren't available. People think that they're all available. You can't buy all the parts for the bed. There's a lot of them that aren't available. They're becoming available. Some of them aren't yet. So what I'm going to do is to prevent water. You know, I don't think moisture is really going to find its way in here. Like I said, it's all in how I take care of it afterwards. And this thing's not going to be in extreme weather probably ever again. But I'm going to clean out this, and then I'm going to put seam sealer in here, and then I'm going to take this, just in case, I'm going to paint this with rust, with a welter primer, because I want to pinch these on here. Okay, so I want welter primer on there so it'll get good contact in there. If I use regular primer, and I'm going to remove this real quick off of here. So I'm trying to think about that. I think I'm going to do it that way. I'm just going to put it on there and then clean that off, put some seam sealer in the crack, and then pinch them on like this, and then weld here. Now it's going to be a little off, but it'll fake in on the next layer that goes on. Yeah, it might see a little bit of a graduation, but then again, when you put the machine on it, of course, that machine's going on. You aren't going to see any of that, you know. So, and that's the way it's going to be. This is never going to be a single cab by itself. This is always going to either have that machine on or taking it on and off. It's going to be gateless. It didn't ever come with gates. Didn't have them from the factory. It's not getting gates. So, that's how I'm going to deal with it right here. And then, of course, it needs to have that. See, it needs to have that piece of metal there, so that when I go to put the tops on, I can bend it around that. And then once this is done and primered and whatever, I finish up this, then I could actually continue to paint some of the inside stuff, which I'm probably not going to get to in this video, of course. But I can actually start painting it inside here. I want to paint all this inside, all inside there, before I put the tops on. So coming soon, I guess those will be kind of the way it's going from what I see right now. Of course, it could change, you know, once I figure out something, you know, how it works. It just, you never know. But that's my plan right now. So let's get on with it. Go ahead and put these on. Guess I'll clean these off with a stripping wheel. Might be the easiest way there. Maybe I'll put a little bit of welter primer on both surfaces. Just because it's easier, like I said. Sometimes I don't use it, sometimes I use it. It just depends on what it is I'm doing. If on this, I'm gonna use it just because some people use it on everything. They say you need to use it. I don't think so. I think there's only certain circumstances that it's really necessary or would even be helpful, because once I weld this, the weld suit primer, wherever I weld it, is gonna be gone. It disappears in those areas. So those are the most prone to rust because they got hot. Anytime you take a piece of metal, let's say you take a piece of metal, you throw it outside, okay? Put it in the weather, and then you take one, you get it hot first, you throw it outside. The one you put out that's hot, that you got hot first, got red hot, it's going to rust first, just so you know. So that welter through primer stuff is not really the fix all. It doesn't fix everything. So anyway, let's move on. Talk to you in the next part. All right, we made a move here on this thing, so got all these things welded. I just got to go through and grind them and take me a few minutes, and then I'm going to actually weld underneath here to keep that lip down. There's just a few spots along there, and then I'll put a bead of seam sealer along there. Yeah, let's look at this thing outside now. Let's look here. Looks like a single cab. Yep, with the door shut, looks pretty good. Just some blind issues, of course. I'm not gonna fix them all. And then if you look over here, yep, still gotta weld that piece in. Still haven't finished that. I don't know when I'll do that. Probably very soon. There's not much else to do. I mean, other than grind that down and do those little edges, and then start finishing up the inside of there and paint that inside. Then, you know, of course, all the rest of the body. A lot more. There's some more welding to do still. Got that little mess down there. A few holes in the floor I'm gonna fix. Just some touch-ups, and then not much. I'm not gonna, like I said, the floor is gonna get a mat on it. It's gonna be covered up. I don't really care if it's like perfectly ribbed original metal. Not on this thing. So, like I said, we're just, if you just look at this thing from where it was after the plasma cut in the framework, you know, until now, it doesn't even look like the same vehicle at all. And it's like coming together. It looks like a truck again when it's all done. And, you know, it's going to look good. It's not going to be like the museum piece, and not intended to be. So, anyway, I'll talk to you guys in the next video. Please like, share, and subscribe. That's about all I can do right now. I've got to get some more shielding gas. I'm almost out before they close today. So, I will go down there and get that, and I'll talk to you on the next one.